Welcome. It's good to be together again for our worship service. It's always good to give thanks. And Paul does this at the beginning of Corinthians when he says this: I always thank God for you because of his grace given to you in Christ Jesus. For in him you've been enriched in every way, in all your speaking and in all your knowledge, because our testimony about Christ was confirmed in you. Therefore, you do not lack any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will keep you strong to the end, so that you'll be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, who has called us into fellowship with his Son Jesus, is Lord, and he is faithful. Let's pray together. Lord, you are the faithful one, and your love reaches down and reaches out to us wherever we are. And so we give you our thanks because you are a God of compassion and understanding, forgiveness and mercy. So we thank you for Jesus and his faithfulness to you and your will. And we ask this morning that our worship will be acceptable. We ask that you would bless us through the words and the prayers and the music, that our coming together may honour your wonderful name. Amen. I bet you weren't aware that today is Yorkshire Sunday. Well, those of us that have visited Yorkshire or maybe know it a little bit, maybe also know of its many merits. Take, for instance, the Yorkshire pudding. The first recipe dates back to 1737, and I don't think it was Auntie Bessie's. But you've also got Yorkshire Parkins and Fat Rascals and all of that. And then there's the cricketing legends. I only know two, and I think Fred Truman and Geoffrey Boycott were of an era when my mother used to watch cricket, so I know them. There's probably many more, but I'm not aware. And I guess we also think about the Bronte sisters, that Haworth Parsonage where they wrote their literary works. And did you know that the first commercial steam train was made near Leeds in 1790? Wensleydale cheese, Wallace and Gromit's favourite, of course, is another Yorkshire product. And stainless steel was made in Sheffield in 1913. Guy Fawkes, who we remember fondly every year, was born and raised in York. And I didn't know that the Children in Need mascot, Pudsey Bear, was named after the creator's hometown. Now, a subject dear to my heart, York, of course, is the home of Kit Kat and Chocolate Orange and Yorkie Bars and many other goodies. And it was a Yorkshireman, Percy Shaw, that invented cat's eyes, and I didn't know that either. Of course, we've got the Tour de Yorkshire, that cycle race that brought Yorkshire to people's attention. We've all got our memories of Yorkshire, and you can think of your own, the people, the places, the things that you like. And I sort of felt that we needed to sing a Yorkshire tune. Well, we sing While Shepherds Watched to the tune of Ilkley Mar Bar Tat sometimes, but it's a bit early for that. So instead, we'll go for the new Scottish hymn band, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
God endures unchanging on. O Lord, we come to you to praise and thank you for the gifts you shower upon us, gifts that we take for granted and frequently don't acknowledge. Help us, O Lord, to be more appreciative, patient and understanding in these difficult times. We thank you that we live in peace, not warring with neighbouring countries. We thank you that we have friends and families giving some joy and happiness. We pray for those who live perpetually surrounded by fear or sorrow because of border unrest, fighting or family strife. We thank you that our fellowship has generally enjoyed a measure of good health despite being surrounded by COVID. We give thanks for clean, efficient hospitals with dedicated doctors, nurses, and all the unseen background workers. We have scientists and chemical engineers experimenting and developing medicines to combat disease and infections. We pray for those living in countries where clean water is a luxury and a remote clinic is the only resource for medical help. Throughout the pandemic, our government has steadfastly attempted to keep on top of the ever-changing new situations that have developed. We may not agree with all the decisions, but we give thanks that there are people prepared to take on the responsibility of national and local government. Pray for those living in countries where no one is able to organise things, or a dictator rules with a rod of iron, or Christian worshippers are persecuted. Living near the countryside, we are aware of the changing seasons. At present, we have tractors towing huge trailers laden with grain going past our door. Then come bales of golden straw to be stored in barns. It seems like a good year for farmers. Our shops rarely have empty shelves, and most of us are in a position to buy whatever we want or need. We thank you, Lord, for your provision. Help us not to take it for granted. We pray for those living in parts of the world where land is not productive, or water is not on hand, and just finding each day's food is a constant struggle. Our service today is only able to be viewed and appreciated by so many because the technology was available. New skills had to be acquired in order to see and participate in these recorded services. We thank you, Lord, for Ian and Irene's continuing commitment to editing and presenting our weekly service and for giving us the ability to adapt to this new form of worship. We thank you that through the service, new friends have been made. We pray for those in the fellowship who have missed out on worship and who anxiously wait to be able to join in praising God in church in September. Amen.
One of our study passages is from Mark chapter 3, starting at verse 20, and I'd like to read it together. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered so that he and his disciples weren't even able to eat. When the family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, "He's out of his mind." And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, "He's possessed by Beelzebub, by the prince of demons. He's driving out demons." So Jesus called and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man. Then he can rob his house. I tell you the truth. All the sins and blasphemies of men will be forgiven them. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. he is guilty of eternal sin. Hard sayings, oh yes, but it is the King of Glory that we're talking about.
Lord, we come to you this morning bringing our prayers of intercession. We pray again for the continued development and implementation of appropriate vaccines. We pray and thank you for the manual council workers who have continued to work, emptying our bins, mowing grass, etc., etc. We pray and thank you for bank clerks, post office workers and shop assistants, who sadly often receive verbal abuse despite continuing to provide a service for us. We pray for those who are refusing to have the vaccine through fear, media and internet pressure, or lethargy. May their decisions be totally rational and not selfish. We pray for those who are housebound. Visitors are perhaps few and social gatherings are no longer happening. Keep them safe and positive in their isolation. Lord, we are travelling through challenging times. Help us to be sensible and obedient. Give us the right words to say at the appropriate time. And always remembering that the will of God will never take you, where the grace of God cannot keep you, where the arms of God cannot support you, where the riches of God cannot supply your need, and where the power of God cannot equip you. Amen.
The words that we're going to sing aren't hard to hear, they're just encouraging. We'll sing shortly, "Believing hearts find promised grace, salvation comes." There is a higher throne, let's sing together.
Oh,
Sometimes things are hard to say, aren't they? And even harder to hear. But sometimes hearing those harder things is necessary. We've all been in the position, haven't we, when we know that we've got to say something to somebody that they don't want to hear. So we find ourselves making all the excuses we can think of to avoid doing it. We maybe hope it'll just all go away, or we'll leave it to somebody else to do. But you and I both know that there are times when we just have to bite that bullet. Of course, the manner in which we deliver this is vitally important, because it can be the difference between taking notice of what's being said or walking off in a huff. Personally, I'm always a bit sceptical of when people talk to me and they begin their sentence with, "I'm saying this in love." And I think, uh-oh, what's coming next? I think we have the same problem as the disciples, in that we're human and we'll have great difficulty in understanding divine concepts. But this week our study takes us to some of those hard things that Jesus said. Well, the particular ones we're going to look at, they deal with the hard sayings about difficult subjects. And that's even worse. We're thinking about blasphemy, forgiveness, obedience, prayer, and communion. They're not in that order in the study book, in which you may have read this last week, but I feel this order flows more naturally. So Jesus had the gifting to be able to deliver difficult words to people, but he had a kind, confident, all-knowing way. And most people listened, maybe with the exception of the church leaders at the time. Jesus' ministry was a supportive and encouraging and instructive one. But if people didn't listen and did their own thing, he very directly told them what was what. He was popular with the crowds of ordinary people, but the leaders saw him as a threat, and they were always seeking to discredit him. And many times when Jesus is explaining things to his disciples, like us, I think they think on an earthly plane, when actually Jesus is addressing spiritual matters. So the first hard saying is about blasphemy, and we find it in Mark 3. I mean, we read it a little bit earlier, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. He is guilty of an eternal sin. Jesus is struggling here to be understood. The religious leaders had him down as being demon-possessed, and because his ministry was attracting crowds, the frustration of the leaders led them to make extreme accusations about Jesus, just really to protect themselves. And Jesus has a wise response to this, and it's twofold. And he says this: a house divided doesn't stand, just as Satan wouldn't oppose himself. And any unwillingness to repent prevents forgiveness altogether, doesn't it? If we liken the Holy Spirit to demons, we're actually turning away from God and the way of forgiveness. We know that Jesus forgives us, and the only sin that is unforgivable is an ongoing refusal to accept Jesus as Saviour of the world. The second hard saying is all about forgiveness, and we'll find that in Matthew 18, and he says, "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart." Now, this comes at the end of the parable of the unforgiving servant. Remember, you know, he had his own debts cancelled, but he refused to have any pity on those owing him. And in the end, he was tortured and imprisoned. And you might think, well, that's a bit of a harsh outcome for a forgiving God. I know from personal experience, and maybe you do too, how hard it is to forgive. Forgiveness isn't a mat, you know, it isn't like a doormat that, you know, allows us people to walk over us, nor is it permission to hurt. It's not even necessarily going to end in reconciliation. But what forgiveness is that even when things are unfair, accepting them, letting go of the hurt and moving forward in peace, not turmoil. Maybe it's closing some doors to people or things that aren't helpful to us. Letting go of resentment, setting up new borders, and hopefully looking to reconciliation taking place. But that's not always a given. You and I know that. But keeping hold of anger and resentment are like shackles that bind and constrict us, and they prevent us living a purposeful life. And Jesus gives clear advice on resolving conflict. He said, first of all, you privately go to that person to talk it out. And then, if necessary, you may involve other people to help. And finally, if all else fails, you involve the church. We need to be a forgiving people if we are to avoid being spiritually paralysed. The third hard saying talks about obedience, and that's found in Mark as well. And it says, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Because God's ways and thoughts are different to ours, as followers, we have to learn a whole new code of conduct. In life, if we know that some of the things we say and do are right and acceptable, that's fine. But alongside that, we also know that there are attitudes and behaviours that can't be tolerated without consequences. And as we're all different, I think we have to personally decide for ourselves within our own conscience how we behave and where we draw the line. And it's a complicated, long line, believe me. But Jesus here was explaining again another lesson to his disciples, and they had to get their heads around all of this. And he says, being a disciple will never be an easy ride. We'll suffer. We won't always get our own way. But Jesus was the epitome of obedience to his Father, wasn't he? Because he left heaven to deal with the world's sin. The unfortunate thing is, we just don't need to have a head knowledge about obedience. We have to practically carry it out. And that's the hard bit, isn't it? Obedience to Jesus means that the focus is totally off us and totally on him. So things will inevitably be different. The fourth hard saying is about prayer. And that comes in John 14, where he says in verse 14, you may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. Those of us who regularly pray may find that statement rather puzzling, but in context, this is probably the final coaching session, if you like, that Jesus has with his disciples, and they're beginning to anticipate earthly life without him. They need help and assurance, and Jesus gives them both in these words. Now, names were very important in biblical times. It wasn't simply a title by which you were known. Names were an integral part of that person and revealed, essentially, the character. I don't know where I went wrong. I mean, fancy calling me Irene, meaning peace. What were my parents thinking? To act in someone's name was either using or abusing both their trust and their authority. For example, a king may give a signed document to one of his servants to act in his name to take to somebody else, say. Just the same as we do today. There's little we do valid without our signature. So to pray in Jesus' name, which we all do, we must be in accordance with his will. And when we pray in Jesus' name, we're effectively bringing our prayers into agreement with the character of Jesus. It's not just an automatic formula which gives us all the answers we would like, attractive as that might be. It's aligning our lives with Jesus, praying for those things that he would be glad to bless. And to achieve that, I think we've got to have a close relationship with him to concur with the Christ-like principles. Prayers for revenge or power or wealth and success are the petty requests that aren't covered by this promise. So we see that it's not a free ticket to get everything we want, because the condition is very clear. We ask in Jesus' name. The fifth hard saying is regarding communion, and John 6 verse 54 says, "Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life." Jesus is speaking here after having just finished miraculously feeding 5,000 people. And a lot of the crowd that were present at the time, I think, probably thought was just a nice free picnic. They again missed the point that Jesus did to, he was illustrating eternal issues. Faith is like eating and drinking of Jesus himself. Jesus knew the sacrifice of Calvary. He knew he was the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. His broken body and spilt blood are appropriated through faith in the act of communion, and we can experience this for ourselves every time we eat bread and drink wine together. What a privilege that is. The communion between Christ and his followers is parallel, I think, to that between God the Father and God the Son. And that speaks to us of the salvation Jesus offers and the eternal life that will triumph over death. So I think we can also see that we're not talking physically about eating and drinking here, but the spiritual union that Jesus has with believers. Not everybody understood then, and some don't even understand now. Maybe they think of the food in a physical sense, like the manna that supplied the children of Israel with food in the desert. But Jesus, of course, was looking to the cross and what that offered. So we have five hard sayings of Jesus, and there are more, obviously, but we've thought particularly about blasphemy, forgiveness, obedience, prayer, and communion. And to me, that's a natural flow of us firstly living without God, and then coming to know and accept his forgiveness in Jesus, and then trying to live an obedient and prayerful life, thus being able, through God's grace, to have communion with Jesus. You know, Ecclesiastes tells us that there's a time for everything. There's a time when we need to hear hard things, and there's a time when softer sayings like, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant," and that'll be music to any Christian's ears. And now it's time for our fellowship prayers. Let's pray together. Lord, daily you bless us. Daily you love us and supply all our needs. So daily we come to you with our thanks and our concerns. So today we want to pray for Jimmy Barris, who's unwell and in hospital. We pray, Lord, the doctors might seek out the problem and successfully get Jim back on his feet. We ask that you'd bless Chris and the rest of the family as they care for him. Olive's been in hospital this week too, and we pray that she might make a speedy recovery and return to the Chesters where she's being cared for. Just bless her and be close to her. Sandra Thurtle, Lord, is never well, but she's currently struggling, so we ask that you would just give her your love. And may she get the attention she so badly needs. We pray, Lord, for Mick and his wife, who both now, on top of everything else, have COVID. So we ask for this couple that you would speak into their lives and into their situation. We pray for one of the street pastor's wives, Pat, who's had a stroke and in hospital too. We ask that there may be recovery there. Lord, we personally don't know all these people, but we know that you do, so we confidently pray. We pray for Carol's friend, Sue, who is now looking after three grandchildren as her daughter is unwell, so we ask you to be close to her and her husband. And we pray, Lord, your continuing hand on Ben and Val and their family. And we ask too for their friend Jane, who's suffering just now. We ask that you would be close to all of them, and bless them, Lord, greatly. Strengthen them. So as we remember, Lord, others known to us, we ask you to be a comfort and a strength to all those dear to us. And we ask our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. The new Methodist choir of Great Britain, the virtual choir that came to being, obviously, during the pandemic, is going to lead us in our final hymn, which is In Christ Alone.
I am his and he is.
Lord, we are your people. We bear your name. Equip us for your service as we go in your name and love for your glory. Just want to thank Chris and Aileen for their prayers and Ian for his techie bits. And if you need to contact us, it's on the screen. One of my favourite pieces of all time is Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. And when David McRae plays it, it's not hard to hear at all. Enjoy, and every blessing.